You're watching the free version of SynthEyes Essentials. For projects and footage, head to BorisFX.com for the premium download. Hello and welcome back to SynthEyes Essentials. So now that we know how to tell SynthEyes which way is up and which way is down, let's try the same thing on something a bit more uneven than a chessboard. In this shot, we've got a fairly simple drone move. The challenge for us is somewhere else. Firstly, we need to find a way to not only align, but also constrain this scene and of course give it some real-world scaling. Once that is achieved, we need to provide our colleagues with a proper mesh of the dunes. So I think we've got our work cut out for us. Let's open up our shot and set it up. This was filmed on a Mavic 4 Pro drone, and that drone has a sensor size of once again 17.3 mm, just like the Lumix cameras from previous classes. Before we finish the setup, I just want to highlight this button here, the image preprocessor. That will be important in a second. Once our shot is loaded up, let's play it back and think about what we'll need from this shot. We've got a very long camera move with a lot of trackable objects appearing and disappearing over time. That will be important when we come to blipping the features. We'll also need to generate a proper mesh for this scene, as we cannot really just align it to a straight ground plane. Let's talk a bit about what kind of mesh we are after. SynthEyes is not a modeling application, and it doesn't have the tools to produce pixel-perfect bevel shapes. But it has got great tools for creating quick and reliable reference geometry, something that gives you or any other CG artist a great starting point to finesse a more detailed model from. SynthEyes can also provide geometry that works great as a shadow catcher or a projection surface inside of a number of compositing applications. With all that being said, our mesh should still be detailed enough to follow the general curvature of the scene. That might be a problem in this area here. There are just very few details on that dune, and if we do an auto track, I fear that we will have no soft 3D points in that area to generate a mesh from. Let's test that assumption. In the summary room, we can just run the auto tracker. That will blip the features with the default settings, peel the trackers, but not perform a solve. It's just a great way to see how the shot behaves in general before we get into all the nitty-gritty of setting up the track. And yes, that area seems to be a tracker void. So let's undo this, and let's try to provide SynthEyes with more features in this pretty featureless area. This is where the image preprocessor comes into play. As the name suggests, it's a way to apply changes to our image before it even enters the SynthEyes tracker. You can set it up on import, or, as we are about to do now, during our work on the shot, either press the shortcut P on your keyboard, I'll go up to the menu bar and select Shot, Image Preprocessor. As you can see, we've got a lot of options to modify the image, starting by simple color adjustments to cropping the image, applying or removing lens distortion, or filters like blurs or high passes, or loading up lookup tables. This part of SynthEyes is really, really powerful. All of these functions are accessible via the tabs up here, and it is definitely worth playing around with those. But be warned. All of these changes are made to the image before it enters the SynthEyes tracker. If you, for example, remove the lens distortion here, then SynthEyes will assume that this is what the image looks like, so you will need to supply that undistorted image to your VFX pipeline as well, or the solve you achieve in SynthEyes will not make any sense. That's why I only want to adjust the color, to boost the image a bit to make it easier for SynthEyes to identify trackable features. The color adjustments will have no direct impact on the way the solve can be applied outside of SynthEyes, so I don't need to worry about passing on these changes to somewhere else, but they will help with my tracking. We could play with the levels or the exposure, but I really would like to adjust the gamma curve down here. Just click and SynthEyes will drop in some handles that you can then move along the curve. Without overexposing the other parts of the dune, we can bring it up to here and have some more features visible. Before we start blipping this sequence for real, I will quickly go to the roto masking room and use Mask ML to create a holdout for the sky. I plan to add quite a lot of trackers, and with those very detailed clouds, I want to avoid having to clean up the sky afterwards. As there are no huge light or perspective changes, one reference on the first frame of our sequence should be enough. There's our little chime, and now we can go over to the features room. I said before that this shot is quite long and that a lot of the features appear and disappear over time. So let's tell SynthEyes to ideally propagate long trackers, at least in this initial first pass. The minimum track length of 50 seems reasonable. And, as we've seen with our auto track, 120 trackers will not nearly be enough for a proper mesh. Let's bump up that maximum tracker count to 700. We can leave the rest at its defaults and blip away. SynthEyes definitely found a lot of raw trackers. Let's clear those, but make sure to not clear the blips. Now head over to the solver room. Select the camera viewer layout. If we play back our clip now, we see that we got what we asked for. A lot of very long living trackers, but despite our best efforts, still not enough in the area here around the dunes. Hold your horses, we'll get to that. These might not be enough trackers for our mesh, but they could very well be enough for solving the shot. So let's give this a go. Switch the layout back to the solver output view and let's take a look. That's not too bad. Nice low error and the alignment doesn't look bad either. Before we fine-tune our alignment, let's color code our point cloud a bit. We've got these different depths of our image and I want to have an easier time identifying which tracker belongs where. In the 3D room, zoom in on the lighthouse and color those guys blue. Next, let's circle around here and color this part cyan. And remember, you can add to your selection by holding down Shift, or subtract by holding down Ctrl and Option on your Mac, or Ctrl-Alt on your PC. Lastly, let's color the whole background orange. And when we shuttle through our scene now, we can see much better which tracker belongs where in the scene. Now it is time to establish a proper coordinate system. And I want us to go the whole 9 yards here and also establish a real-world scale and proper constraints. With no chessboards in sight, we will have to turn our attention to one of the very few man-made objects in this scene, the lighthouse. This scene was shot in Denmark at Logan Beach and the lighthouse is called Ruber Knude. If you look that up on Wikipedia, you can not only find the fascinating story about how this lighthouse was saved from being knocked over, but also down here you can see that this is 23 meters high. Let's create a box that is 23 units high. Now normally we would use the different viewers to move the lighthouse into place, but the moment we do that, we start to change the scale, so that won't work. Instead, we have to move everything else to fit that box. It's a bit like wagging the dog with its tail, but it'll make sense in a minute. So to move everything, we need to select Whole. But now we are moving the box together with everything else. We do not want that, so let's call for an undo. If we right-click in any of the orthogonal views, we can go to 3D and uncheck Whole Effect Meshes. That way, moving around the entire world will not move the meshes. Now it is worth pausing for a moment and thinking about the order in which we approach these tasks. I'm establishing the coordinate system and the real-world scale before I create the mesh. That is on purpose, because once I generate a mesh from the point cloud and have that in place, I don't want to move the world independently from the meshes anymore, because that would totally break the alignment of the generated mesh. With that being said, let's move our world to fit our lighthouse point cloud around our 23 unit high box. The first thing I want to do is to angle the scene a little bit better. Right now, the points representing the front wall of the lighthouse look like they are totally straight up the Z-axis. But if we take a look at the image, we see that the wall is actually tapered in a bit. I don't know the exact degree, so I will have to eyeball that. I will not model the lighthouse in more detail. As I said, SynthEyes is not really the place to do that. But the box will give us not only the scaling reference, but also some rough geometry that you can then use in CG to build a more detailed version of the lighthouse, if that is what you're after. Right-click and reactivate Whole Effects Meshes again. Now you can move everything into place. I want to make sure that the camera is flying right along the y-axis and that I don't have any points below the ground plane. That is all personal preference, so set this up in a way that works best for you. But once we are done, we need to constrain the scene. In the last class, we had the luxury of the very straight and identifiable lines on the chessboard. But even Rubia Knude is tapered, so that's tough luck. But it's not that big of an issue, as long as we are happy with the alignment we just created. Instead of forcing our scene precisely onto the origin point or the ground plane, we are instead going to select a bunch of trackers that will serve as anchor points to keep the scene exactly in place. SynthEyes calls these anchors lock points. For a lock point, we will want a tracker that has a really low error. Why? Well, it's going to serve as a constraint to our scene, so you don't want it to be cleared out by your next run of the cleanup trackers dialog. Let's switch over to the coordinates room and search for some nice low error trackers. This one looks good, so let's turn it into a seed point and set it to lock point. As a lock point, it will inherit the exact same coordinates that it was solved to, so naturally, the error up here is zero. Don't forget to turn seed off again. How many of these will we need? A good ballpark figure is around 6. But here's a little tip for you to make that process a bit quicker. By holding down Shift, you can select multiple trackers, and in the error curve mini view, you will see an amalgamation of all those error curves. And if you accidentally select one that has got a high error, like this one, just click on it again while still holding down Shift to deselect. Once you're happy with your selection, you know the deal. Turn them into seed points, then choose lock point and turn seed off again. Voila! A nicely scaled and constrained scene, even though there are no straight lines to talk about. Good job on scaling and constraining the scene. Take a little breather and then join me in the second part of this class, where we will finally focus on the mesh generation itself. See you there.